Hey everybody, welcome to Wednesday Night Live. We're so glad you're here with us, whether you're watching from home or if you're watching here at the building. Welcome, and we're so glad again that you've joined us. All of you, wherever you're at, you're invited to comment along on the video. Everyone that comments is entered to win our weekly DoorDash prize. You can get a free meal delivered from us right to your house, and well, DoorDash will bring it to you, and we won't cook it either, but we'll pay for it, and you get to enjoy it. So all of you, again, if you're here at the building, take out your phone, comment along, let us know you're here and have fun. If you're at home hanging out, comment along, have fun as well. Get a chance to win that prize. We've got a great opportunity for virtual small groups for our online student ministry group, and anyone that's here at the building will be sticking around for small groups right after the premiere. We also have a big, awesome opportunity for our clubs, our campfires, as we're calling them. We've got a lot of different opportunities, including this Sunday afternoon at 2 o'clock. We have photography, Polynesian dance, soccer, volleyball, and basketball. So 2 o'clock on Sunday, come on out to the building, invite a friend. We've got 5 opportunities to do some really fun, awesome things, so don't miss it. And then this Friday at 6 o'clock, we have a middle school only night. So all 6th, 7th, and 8th graders are invited. It's free. We're gonna just hang out, play some games, have some pizza. Again, it's middle school only this Friday night, 6 to 8 o'clock. So a lot of stuff coming up, so don't miss the opportunity. And one more thing, it's almost the end of September, which means that we're about to give out our October subscription box. You have about 5 days left if you have never subscribed to our subscription box. You've got about 5 days left. You can find the link in our newsletter. It's also in the bio of our Instagram page. So Clyde Student Ministry on Instagram, check the bio for the link, and then you'll find the subscription there. Invite a friend, get somebody else involved, and help them get plugged in to our subscription box. It's gonna be awesome. You guys are not gonna wanna miss it. So let's play some games, have some fun, and we're glad you guys are here with us tonight.
Hello.
Hey everybody. Hi. Hey, we're gonna play a fun game called AB Cheese. We're gonna play the AB Cheese, and the way this game works is that we're gonna take some turns biting alphabet letters out of this medium cheddar cheese, and the other two people have to try to be the first person to guess what letter that we're trying to make. So we have to make letters with cheese. Two people have to try and guess, you know, and we'll just say this, like, you can guess one time, and then you gotta wait like 3 or 4 seconds before you can guess again. So don't just go flying through the alphabet. So I'm gonna go first. We're gonna pick our own letters, and I'm gonna start us off with a really just a high quality letter.
High quality letter.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, like visualize. Here we go. You guys ready?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's right. Time to be an artist. How do I? Okay. Okay. Ready?
Mm-hmm.
Hey,
you. Oh,
C.
Oh, I did. Yeah.
Yeah. Egg win! Or this? I don't know. Yes. That's a lot of cheese.
Very good.
Yeah. Alright, Gwen. Just going for the cheese. It's
How you do this? Maybe I'll go this way.
Interesting.
That's good cheese.
It's good cheese? It's not bad, huh? L! Yes!
I was gonna say, Louisiana! Or Kentucky! Okay.
Oh!
It broke.
You.
Yep.
Now we're here. Cup of cheese.
Cup of cheese.
All right. For this round, let's all challenge ourselves to try a harder, more complicated letter. Mm. I'm to believe.
Believe me.
Oh, yeah. Who's getting technical?
Around here, you're known as the big cheese.
The big
Z.
Yeah!
Yes!
Right?
Oh, yes, it does look like a Z.
That was pretty good.
Z for zebra.
Okay.
You gotta hold it up. What is that?
X.
X? Oh my gosh. I was like, that is not a letter. It looks like a cheese ninja star.
Wow.
Yeah.
It looks
like
that.
All right, this game is called Teen Slang. And so what we've done is we've found throughout the ages, right, throughout all of time, words that teenagers said at some point, but not all of these are real. Some of these are made up. So you need to decide if these are real teenage slang words from like present or 20, 30, 50, 60 years ago, or if this is a completely made up slang word. And because we want to use cool slang and cool words, if you think it's real, then that means you're gonna call it radical. If you think it's fake, then it's bogus.
Bogus.
All right, so it's either radical or bogus, real or fake.
Okay.
All right, very first one, the word is hootie. Like a sweetheart, girl, boyfriend, someone that you're dating, a hootie. Like, who's your hootie? Do you think that's real or fake? Radical or bogus?
I'm gonna say bogus.
I was thinking Hootie and the Blowfish.
Hootie and the Blowfish. It is real. Oh, radical. Man. Okay, this says this is from the 2000s. I was a teenager in the 2000s. I never heard anyone say Hootie, but that's just me. All right, this next one is the word is Jake. Like J-A-C-K, Jake. All right, cool, things are good, things are well. Is everything Jake out there? Like that's an example. Do you think that's like a real slang word? A cool,
I'm gonna say what the cool kids say.
If that's real?
I'm gonna say it's radical.
I'm gonna say bogus.
It is radical. This one goes back to the 1910s, supposedly 110 years ago.
Wow.
110 years ago. Is everything Jake out there?
Wow.
It's all Jake. Okay, you guys can use some of these. Now you need to learn new cool words. Okay, this one is a red grin grumbolt. Someone who has no clue, they don't know what's going on. You guys are all real red grin grumbolt of Reddit. You're all the red green grumbolts of Reddit. That's what the cool kids would say.
Bogus.
I'm gonna say radical.
All right, it is bogus. Red grin grumbolt. It's not real. Okay, here we go. A ducky shin cracker. Someone who dances well. A ducky shin cracker. He may be a nerd, but he sure is one ducky shin cracker.
I'm gonna say radical.
You think that's real?
I'm gonna say bogus.
That is real from the 1940s.
Oh,
it's radical.
It sounds like they would talk in the 40s.
Right? I don't know like what a 40s accent would be, but like,
yeah.
Oh yeah, he's a real ducky shin cracker.
It's cutting my ass.
Yeah. Here's another one. Hundo P. Hundo P. This means definitely, for sure. Hundo P. Maybe like 100%? Like Hundo P? Like, she Hundo P knew she would pass the English exam.
I'm gonna say bogus.
I'm gonna say radical.
It should be bogus. It's real!
Hundo P.
It says from the 2010s, which means some of you guys have been, tell us please in the comment section. Or
right.
Did you guys say Hundo P? Goodness. Okay, we'll do a couple more real quick. A honey rhyme lumper. A honey rhyme lumper. Someone who knows how to rap really well.
Bogus.
So like...
gotta be bogus.
Yo, Drake is a honey rhyme lumper. My man Drake is a honey rhyme lumper.
Because it sounds so funny, I'm
going to
say
what
random.
What about a honey badger?
It's bogus.
You can see I'm not a slang person.
Oh my gosh.
Oh, I got one.
Okay. This is the the last one. This one cracks me up. The slang term is banks closed. Like, hey, the bank's closed. It means no kissing or no making out. So like if you use it in a sentence, like I would tell Emily, I would say, Emily, I'm sorry, babe. Bank's closed.
I'd say radical.
I'd say radical too. That sounds like it could be real.
It's real. Radical from the 1920s.
Wow.
So the 1920s, like,
banks
no.
Bank's closed.
So now you guys know if somebody's trying to get too familiar, he's like, no, bank's closed.
Thanks.
Yeah. All right. Well, now you guys learned some really cool new words. Congratulations. Thanks for playing, guys. What's up, everybody? Welcome back to Wednesday Night Live. This is our fourth message from our fourth week in our series called Exiles. We've been following along the story of a group of teenagers who were kidnapped from their home and taken to a faraway land called Babylon. Now, Babylon is the biggest, baddest country in the world. They've got all the power and all the money, all the fine things. They're really smart. They have great technology. But Babylon is a dangerous, broken, and dark, dark place. Babylon at this time was ruled by a king named King Nebuchadnezzar. And we read last week and talked about how the king had a dream, and he was so freaked out about his dream that he threatened to kill all of his wise men unless they could tell him what his dream was and what it meant. And we know from last week that Daniel fully relied on God, that he took this horrible situation that he had no control over, and he put all of his faith and hope into God's hands, and God delivered him. Today we're going to look at a story that's a little different, but the hope is the same. Now, also the same is a crazy, crazy King Nebuchadnezzar situation. This guy, at the end of last week's story, you might remember, he actually gave praise and honor to God and praise and honor to Daniel, and he's like very impressed. But being a crazy, all-powerful king in his own mind makes him do really crazy things. When you think you're the biggest, baddest person on the planet and you're the king of the biggest country, then you kind of have a really bad ego problem, and that gets you into some trouble and gets other people into trouble. So today's story, we're going to be in Daniel chapter 3. And before we dive in, I want to share a question with you that I was asked by our friend Brandon. So Brandon asked us the other night, if you could control one element, like if you were basically in Avatar, what kind of like airbender, earthbender, fire, what is it, air, earth, fire, water? What would you want, like, if you had that superpower to control an element? Like, what would you want to have? I think about it. I think airbending would be really cool. But honestly, you got to get this picture of the Fire Nation, right? Like, the Fire Nation is powerful. They're ruthless. They're mean. And, like, fire is pretty tough to beat. It's really, really funny because when I look at this story again and again in the book of Daniel, the nation of Babylon pretty much is the Fire Nation from Avatar. So just kind of keep that in the back of your mind. These are like really, really rough military power, like power hungry people. And they've got the fire, and they're actually really, really obsessed with fire. The people of Babylon, the king of Babylon, like fire is kind of the representation of their power. It's a representation of like what they worship. It's the strength and just the raw, like, destructive power that fire has. Now, we know that fire is a real thing. Like, fire is a real, obviously, element that is dangerous, and fire is something that maybe you and I have had some weird encounters with. One question you can tell us again in the comment section or in small group time later, have you ever seen, like, a wild, crazy fire, out-of-control fire? Have you ever seen, like, a really big, crazy firework explosion or something, like, you know, got a little too hot and just blew up. Just kind of curious. Those are always funny stories. I know one time I've got a crazy story about when we lit a mattress on fire, like a bed mattress that we found in the woods. It ended really badly, but I can tell you that story another time. Fire is a big part of this story, and there's a reason. Again, Babylon was really impressed with fire. Fire was the go-to, I'm going to intimidate someone and show them how big and bad I am, and I'm going to show them, like, you know, fire is kind of the symbol of that. So just keep that in mind. So this story starts in Daniel chapter 3. The exiles have been living in Babylon for years now, And if you remember at the end of last story, Daniel and his friends were all promoted. So they've been promoted to some pretty important jobs. And at this point, the king has gotten a really great idea. Well, in his mind, it's a really great idea. He builds this golden image, like this golden statue, and he sets it up. And he tells everybody that when we blow the horns and play all of the music, everybody needs to bow down and worship this statue. And I'm pretty sure the statue looks like him. Like, it's kind of like, I really want everyone to worship me, but you let's build a big gold statue and you can worship that instead. Like, this guy is super, super into himself, right? Like, could you imagine somebody like in your neighborhood or someone in your school like knocking on doors and saying, hey, tonight at 6 o'clock, I need everybody to come outside and bow down and worship me. You're like, no, like, what's wrong with you? Please get away from my door. But the King Nebuchadnezzar, like, you know, his mindset is I am the biggest and the baddest and everybody should worship me. So big, massive gold statue. When the music starts playing, everybody needs to bow down and worship it. That makes sense. So the heralds, the guys that make the announcement, this is Daniel chapter 3, verse 4. They come out and proclaim, you know, nations of every people and every language. This is what you're supposed to do. As soon as you hear the music, you must fall down and worship the image of gold that King Nebuchadnezzar has set up. Right? So there's the instructions. But verse 6, whoever does not fall down in worship will immediately be thrown into a blazing furnace. Right? So there's the firepower. There's the do what I tell you or we're going to get the blazing hot furnace fire going and we're going to toss you in there. You're going to be a toasted marshmallow if you don't listen and do what we say. So, verse 7, they get everything set up. They play the music. Everyone bows down. Well, not quite everybody bows down. So kind of jumping down at verse 8. At this time, some astrologers came forward and they denounced these Jews, the exiles that were kidnapped and brought to Babylon. They said to the king, may you live forever. You know, you made this rule, right? That everyone is supposed to bow down before the statue. Well, verse 12, there's some of these Jews whom you have set and you've given them a promotion. You remember that? You promoted them. Well, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they don't care about your rules, your majesty. They're not worshiping your gods. They're not worshiping your statue. You know, they're not doing what you asked. So these guys were tattletales. Quite honestly, they were probably jealous that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego got promoted and they didn't. So they go and tell the king, hey, when the music played, those three guys over there, they didn't bow down. Yeah, everybody hates a tattletale, but you know, these guys were thinking only of themselves, right? They probably, again, were jealous that they didn't get promoted. Verse 13, it's chapter 3, verse 13. King Nebuchadnezzar was furious with rage. So he summoned Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and they were brought before the king. And the king kind of, his first round is like, did you guys not realize what I said? Like, did you not know that, you know, when the music plays, you bow down before the statue, or you get your butt thrown into the fiery furnace? Did you miss that? Does that make sense? And you guys, well, let's just soak in this response, because this is one of the greatest responses to pressure. It's one of the greatest responses to a trial or a hard situation that I've ever seen in anywhere. Verse 16, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to him, King Nebuchadnezzar, we don't need to defend ourselves. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to deliver us from it. And he will deliver us from your majesty's hand. We believe that. But verse 18, even if God does not deliver us, even if we get thrown into the fiery furnace and just get absolutely destroyed, even then, we want you to know, your majesty, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold you have set up. These three men, the exiles, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they have looked right at the king, right into the heart of their problem, and they've said, we believe that God can save us. So there's the first thing. You guys, when we're in really hard situations, when we're in a situation we don't want to be in, or a situation where we feel like we need to stand up for what's right, we have to start with that belief, that hope, and that faith that God can save us. God can save you from any situation. God can save me from any situation. There's never a point where we're so far away, right? We're so lost that we can't be found. There's never a point in our life where we're so broken and we've made so many mistakes that we can't be saved and picked up and put back on our feet. There's not a situation that's so dark that we can't find God's light to lead us through it. We believe that God can save us. And they say, King, we believe God can, and we know he will. So they've got some confidence there. But the most amazing part of what they said is the next part, again, from verse 18. We know God can, right? So I'm going to walk in faith because I know God can save us and lead us out of this. But even if he doesn't, God is still good, and God still knows what's going on in my life. God still cares, and God has a plan that's just bigger than I understand. Even if God doesn't save us from this fire, we're still going to do what we know is right. So the king was absolutely furious with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. At this point, they basically were like, yeah, whatever with your rules and your fire, you know, they don't care. So King Nebuchadnezzar is so furious, his attitude changed towards them. And he orders the furnace to be heated 7 times hotter than usual. And the king commanded his strongest soldiers in his army to tie up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and throw them into the blazing furnace. So these men, wearing all of these robes, trousers, they're wearing hats and clothes and everything, they were tied up and thrown into the blazing furnace. It was so hot, the fire was so hot, that the king's men, the strongest men from his military, his soldiers, the flames actually were so hot that those men died as they tried to throw Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego into the fire. That's how hot the fire was. These 3 men, firmly tied, fell into the blazing furnace. The soldiers who were tossing them in, so hot that they died. Verse 24, the king leapt to his feet in amazement, and he asked, whoa, weren't there 3 people that we tied up and threw into the fire? They replied, certainly, your majesty, right? We can count Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego. It was 3. The king then approached, said, look, I see 4 men walking around in the fire, unbound and unharmed, and the 4th looks like the son of the gods. King Nebuchadnezzar then approached the opening of the blazing furnace and shouted, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out, come over here. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came out of the fire, and all of the leaders, the prefects, governors, the royal advisors, all the people that were present crowded around them. They saw the fire had not harmed their bodies, nor their hair, nor the robes or the hats or anything that they wore. They didn't even smell like fire or smoke. So King Nebuchadnezzar said, praise be to the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and rescued his servants. They trusted in him and defied the king's command and were willing to give up their lives rather than serve or worship any god except their own God. Therefore, I decree that the people of any nation or language who say anything against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego be cut into pieces and their houses be turned into piles of rubble, for no other god can save in this way. So the king realizes again another opportunity that he's going to worship the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He does it in a pretty weird way, like anybody that talks trash about God has to be cut into pieces and their house torn down. But, you know, I guess that's kind of a win. He's growing slowly, but he's still a crazy person. Yes, the point of this story for all of us, again, is if we know who God is and we understand that God has called us to live and follow and be like Jesus, right, that God has called us to live and be set apart in this way, that when we're in these hard situations, we can, one, believe that God can save us. God can get us through. God is able, right? We're never too lost. We're never too broken. You know, it's never too hopeless. God can save us. And we can have the faith and the confidence to believe that God can do that. And then in these moments, that even if things look bad and even if things get worse, I'm still going to believe in the goodness of God. I'm still going to have hope. What does that look like for you this week? And what does that look like for us moving forward in this year? Even if things look bad, even if things are hard right now, God is still with us and God can save us. And even if things get worse, God is going to be there. We don't know what the future holds, but we know who holds the future. We can fully rely on God in every part of our life and every situation that we're in. So tonight we have an update for you guys. We have something to make sure everyone understands, and that way we can, you know, move appropriately and respond appropriately. But some of you may have heard and seen that there was an announcement made this last weekend that we want to explain and then give you guys some information about it. So our church and everything we do is funded through the giving and generosity that comes in every week through giving. It's why God gives us the invitation to give, to be obedient and generous, to overflow in our life, so that the church building and the ministries and the staff and everything that's a part of the church at Severn Run can operate. And if you guys didn't know, you know, this is our job. So we do this as a full-time job. And so our jobs are reliant on that giving and generosity. And our church and our community, like many churches and communities across the country, have been impacted. And so an announcement was made on Sunday that due to the financial situation that our church is in, that there was going to be some positions, some staff positions at church that were going to be cut. And one of those positions is the position of student ministry. It's Daniel's position on staff with Clyde Student Ministry. So what this means is we're losing a staff position, we're losing a office chair, we're losing the nameplate on a door kind of thing. Like, we're losing the position of ministry for a second student pastor. And what we're not losing is the person, the heart, soul, flesh and blood, the person we all know and love, of Daniel Leonard. And so, again, to kind of clarify, you know, there's a couple positions that our church are going to have to cut for financial reasons. And you guys, we've known this for a little bit. We've known this for a couple weeks. Wanted to tell you guys, and this is for so many different reasons. 2020 is the worst. It's weird to do this in a video too. We wish we could be with all of you guys to have all these conversations, but we wanted to tell you and give you the information and let you know and let you understand a little bit of why. We've said this a couple different times, but everything is worth saying again. All right, so know that everything's worth saying again. We all love Daniel. I know you all love Daniel, and we love his family, and we love everything about who he is and the way that, really, you know, we're in this story in the Bible of Daniel. Daniel Leonard handles every situation like Daniel in the Bible did. Every situation with faith, with grace, with kindness and love. So Daniel is finishing out his position on staff this week. But Daniel doesn't cease to exist this week or cease to care or love you this week. So this is a hard announcement to make, and I think we all can do a couple different things, but first wanted to pass to Daniel just to kind of share the update from your side, what this, from your heart, just what the future looks like and just what today looks like for you.
Well, my position here in the body of Christ may be changing, but it doesn't change who I am. It doesn't change my purpose. It doesn't change God's plan for my life. In fact, I think just the opposite. It is God's plan. And the book of Daniel has a lot of stories that are my favorite ones, that really show a strong faith. And, you know, God has always provided for me and my family. And I know that He's got it in His hands, and He's never late. His love is perfect. And the joy that He gives me is supernatural. So I'm not worried, but it is a little sad. To be honest, gets a little harder every day to think that I won't be able to come here every day as my job. But God gives me peace. And I know that I don't have to worry. So I'll be available if anybody has any questions or just wants to talk until Sunday. And then I'm going to take a few weeks just to be with the Lord, see what he's got next. Now, I don't know what's next, and that's okay. But I'll just seek him, and he'll reveal the next step.
And you guys, I mean, I know Daniel means that. If you want to reach out, and everything's worth saying. So if you want to reach out and let Daniel know how much you love him, Arcadia and the family, do it. There's no reason not to. And we're going to be praying. We're going to pray together, and we invite you to pray for Daniel, for the family. Pray for Clyde's student ministry. Pray for all of us as we figure out what do we do next. I mean, this is a real life opportunity, right? We've just been talking about, we believe God can do this. We believe God can provide what we need. We believe that God can be faithful, and God is good. So we're going to pray for that, and we're going to pray together and care for each other. And you know, for those who are here with us at the building on Wednesday night, we're here to talk. Those who are going to be online tonight and have virtual small groups, you guys can reach out and talk with us anytime. So we just want you to know that we're here for you. Daniel's here for you, and you know, we're going to be praying for Daniel and praying for his family. So what we're going to do is just kind of close in prayer, and then we're gonna have a moment to worship, and then go on with the rest of our night and on till tomorrow, because God knows what the future holds for each of us, and we love and trust his plan for our life, and we just believe that God is good, and we can't wait to see what comes next. So let's pray. God, thank you so much for Daniel. Thank you for his heart. Thank you for the love and light that you've placed inside of him. We pray for this moment in all of our lives that we, God, can use this opportunity. God, this is a moment where we either believe big or we don't. We either love well, we either live Jesus, or we don't. And we know that Daniel has and will do that. I pray for all of us, God, that we will take those things seriously, that we believe that you can and you will do great things, that you have a plan for the future. For all of the students and all the families, for all of the people that make up Clyde Student Ministry, I pray that you, God, use this as a reminder that we get to do this together. We get to be a part of something special, and we get to be a part of a church, God, that loves you. And so I pray that we use that energy to encourage each other and love each other well. And God, we pray for the Leonard family and just for their hearts. Give them peace and rest, God, and show them what comes next. And each of us, as we go out to school and activities and home, God, just lead us and guide us every day. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
To repeat after me, surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. Darkest night. close like no other. I know you as a father. I know you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. In all my life, you have been faithful.
Thank you guys again for joining us. Daniel and I are going to keep you up to date on just what's going on just in our lives and in ministry, and we're all in this together. So let's continue to pray for each other, to encourage each other, because we know without a doubt that God has a plan for each of our lives, and God has a plan for what's coming next, and that you are a part of this. You're a part of the life of those sitting next to you, for those who are connected and watching all around the country and all around the community right now. We're all connected through the hope and the love and the light of Jesus, and God has a plan. So we're going to seek that and believe and trust in God no matter what, that He has a plan and goodness for us. So we're going to seek that together. And tonight, right after this message, we're going to have small group time. So for those who are virtual tonight, you can hop on Zoom. That'll go about 7:45 to 8:15. For those that are here with us at the building, small groups are going to start right now. Don't forget, we've got a middle school event this Friday night. We've got clubs this weekend. Subscription boxes are coming out very soon, so don't forget to subscribe to that. And that we love you guys. We're so glad you're with us. We're going to go ahead and put the prize winner in the comment section right now for your weekly DoorDash prize giveaway. And we hope to see you guys again very soon. We're praying for you and your week, praying for your school, your family, your neighborhood. And again, we hope to see you guys very soon. Have a good night.